This is Clean TV, family-friendly conservative national news on demand. I'm Jerry McLaughlin reporting what's happening on Wednesday, June 30th, 2010. Gun owners are still exuberant over yesterday's 5-4 United States Supreme Court ruling that affirms fundamental gun ownership rights to U.S. citizens, rebuffing calls from U.S. authorities on all levels to override private gun ownership, and ignoring the extreme political correctness pressures from liberal political establishments, the high court struck down tough gun laws imposed by Chicago and one of its nearby suburbs. Writing on behalf of the majority opinion was Justice Samuel A. Alito, Jr., who said, quote, "It is clear that the framers counted the right to keep and bear arms among those fundamental rights necessary to our system of ordered liberty," unquote. The ruling should enable gun rights advocates to challenge restrictive gun laws on the books locally across the country. Clean TV applauds this correct decision, but cautions Americans to be sure to turn out and vote this November and not to get lax, and again in 2012 to elect leaders who will uphold the Constitution. For if we were to lose one or more Supreme Court vote, this 5-4 decision could have easily gone the other way and been 4-5. And with the ongoing hearings on the ultra-liberal Justice Elena Kagan, the liberals nearly have their replacement already for outgoing Supreme Court Justice John Paul Stevens, with only one new justice afterward to revoke many of the protections in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights that, frankly, so many of us just take for granted as being there forever. But the price for freedom is eternal vigilance. We must never forget that. It was like something out of a James Bond movie, sleeper cells of Russian agents stationed in the United States, posing as typical American families. Wasn't from the 50s, wasn't even from the 60s or the 70s. It was the year 2010. And there was a massive arrest of Russian spies. They were sent here from Russia to infiltrate, document, and recruit for the Kremlin. 11 members, some say 10, we're still waiting to get the exact number, of the spy network now face criminal charges of failing to register as foreign agents and money laundering. While none of the secret agents were believed to have obtained classified documents, the agents were trained in Russia and matched with partners of the opposite sex, encouraged to assume family roles, including parenting children who were unaware of their parents' secret identities. Imagine that. Members of the Illegals program were tracked down and taken down in Yonkers, New York, Montclair, New Jersey, Boston, and Northern Virginia. Some had been operating here since the mid-1990s, and our next story delves deeper into this topic. Kind of makes you wonder what kind of person would bring children into this world with an assigned mate, all for the purpose of espionage? It's not exactly what I call family value, and talk about the abuse of children in the process. I shudder to think. Cliff Kincaid of America's for Survival has just given Clean TV some interesting insight into the arrest of 10 or 11 alleged Russian intelligence operatives who we've discussed a moment ago, arrested in the United States. Kincaid asks, quote, "Does this touch too closely for comfort for Obama? He just entertained the Russian president in Washington and signed a nuclear arms reduction treaty with the Russians that critics say puts the U.S. at a strategic disadvantage. Have Russian agents over-influenced the Obama administration? Are the indictments of the Russian spies a signal to Obama that someone in the FBI is watching him?" Unquote. The reality of the situation is that the Obama administration and his Attorney General, Eric Holder, could not have easily stopped these arrests even if they wanted to, because this is what was called a quote-unquote multi-year investigation, meaning that it started before Obama took office, and it would have been an act of high treason to have stopped the investigation before it ran its due course. So they had no alternative but to let the investigation proceed. But why on earth would Obama have wanted to stop these arrests in the first place? That's the question at hand. Simple. His childhood mentor, Frank Marshall Davis, was a member of the pro-Russian Communist Party USA. That's right. and old habits and philosophies die hard. Especially for someone who wrote his book, Dreams of My Father, and named a man named Frank in that book and put him on a pedestal, oohing and eyeing over Frank, an obvious reference to his mentor and surrogate father, Frank Marshall Davis, the communist. The 600-page FBI file on Frank Marshall Davis is available to view at Cliff Kincaid's website at usasurvival.org. Now, in an exclusive interview earlier with Clean TV, Cliff Kincaid stated, quote, "Let's hope the investigations continue into the influence of Russian secret agents into Obama's foreign policy. Obama was under the influence of pro-Russian agent since he was a kid. Davis was the mysterious Frank from Obama's book, Dreams My Father," unquote, says Mr. Kincaid. Some powerful words from Cliff Kincaid, who, by the way, used to be the substitute host for Patrick Buchanan on the CNN classic political program, Crossfire. I remember it well. In other Supreme Court rulings, by a decision of 5-4, the High Court declared that Christian organizations do not have the right to deny membership or leadership roles to non-believers, but has been met by disappointment. Now, the Supreme Court ruling upheld a California law's denial of official recognition of a Christian student group that refused to agree to let non-Christians become voting members or leaders. The American Center for Law and Justice filed an amicus brief with the High Court in the case of Christian Legal Society versus Martinez. Jay Sekulow, chief counsel of the ACLJ, said, quote, "This is an extremely disappointing decision that significantly damages the constitutional rights of religious organizations," unquote. This case involved a decision by the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit, siding with the Hastings College of Law in San Francisco. Hastings denied official recognition to the Christian Legal Society after student-led organizations said it could not abide by the school's non-discrimination policy. That policy, by the way, forbade student groups from discriminating on the basis of, among other things, quote-unquote, religion. And in another closely watched case, the U.S. Supreme Court has refused to hear an appeal from a group of parents in North Texas who wanted to stop the school district in the Dallas suburb of Plano from regulating when students could or could not be allowed to pass out Christian material to their classmates. Now, this historic case stems from then third grader who was denied permission to hand out a candy cane pen to his classmates with a Christian message during the so-called winter party. At the time, the Plano, Texas school district also told some of their students that they could not write Merry Christmas on cards that they had planned to send to U.S. troops overseas. The school district eventually changed their policy to allow students to pass out material featured religious messages, but restricted the times that they could hand them out. Kelly Shackerford of the Liberty Institute said, quote, "These attacks serve to remind us of the need to remain vigilant in every aspect of society, but especially to guard our children," unquote. Applause, applause. Surprise, Clean TV agrees with Ms. Shackerford. This concludes another edition of Clean TV, family-friendly news on demand. Thank you for watching. I'm Jerry McLaughlin reporting.